that was a nightmare. A nightmare. Luckily, I've got it working again. First, I had to figure out how to turn the damn thing on, of course. But then, we got it going. Interesting. I don't know 100% that this is working. Looks like it. Okay, cool. Let's find out. I'll push the Windows key. Boom, we're good. All right, it was that stupid boost thing on Omen computers. It boosted me, and I didn't need it boosted. Okay, so let's see if I can remember what we're going to do. Oh, yeah, okay. So we were going to do, let's go ahead and do color smaller ones of these. So we're going to replace all this shit. All right, so, oops. Let's go here. And then we'll go here. Yeah. And we'll go here. Cool. Hopefully these aren't, and they are. Okay. Let's go open. Maybe I can do the fours on here. Cool. Yes, I can. So we'll do the smaller ones on here. We don't need these two. So let's just do them all. And remember that on the smaller ones, we're going to make these singles. So, I mean, single actions. And I'll show what I mean by that. So we'll take these off. We're going to make the fours. Maybe we can delete those. Delete that. Delete that. Delete that. Delete that. And that'll be red. Boom. Delete that. That'll be blue. Boom. Make that purple. And make that one green. Oops. One too many deletes. Okay. Oh yeah, and then these all. I'll go here, type, find change. We'll change fives into fours. We'll go find, change all, done. We'll put these aside. We'll get our threes. We're going to get these and we're going to lock them. Control 2. And we'll come back over here. And we'll put that to the front. We'll come over here. Oops. And we'll turn these into threes. And then we'll turn these. Go type, find change. We'll change fours into threes. Find, change all, done. And since we locked the other ones, yeah, see they stayed the same. Move those there, move these here. Let's do the twos. Oh, let's lock these. We'll select these, control two. Type, find change, change threes into twos, find all, change all, done. Let's go ahead and change these into twos. I'm going to do ones. I don't know if I should. I mean, in the long run, I guess it won't matter. I'm going to do them just to do them, and I'll have them. Just seems crazy to do them though. I've been wondering. Okay, I'm gonna do them. We'll just do them because it's not gonna take much to do them. Taking longer to think about it than to do it. I'm probably not going to need them. It's just going to be extra work. Oh, we don't need to do that because they're so small, they're not going to have numbers. Cool. Done. All right, we'll unlock them all. We'll control 2. We'll turn these numbers into outlines. We'll save that. That's how big of an area we're dealing with. We're dealing with a small enough area. I can put all these sorted together. Let's not do that. Let's do this though. They'll get the threes. We'll do that. And then we're going to save a big JPEG. And we'll call this that. The next is time to start saving. So we'll go ahead and do it systematically. We'll delete all the fours and then all the threes. I mean, all everything but the fours. And then we'll delete these and then delete these and then delete that. Okay. And we'll call that 001. You know, if anything, I hope this little series of showing how games are made, designed, and played with will A, make you realize that it takes a lot of work to get all this crap done, and 2, to appreciate, you know, every card and how many iterations it had to go through and what it took to playtest everything. And just a tremendous amount of work that it takes to put into bringing a game to market. And I can tell you, unless, you know, it's a really game that sells really well, the designers aren't really getting compensated nearly enough for the work that they have to do on a smaller indie project, because it's a hell of a lot of work. I mean, for me, it is a passion. Because if it wasn't, it totally wouldn't be worth it. And I don't mean just like for monetary reasons. But you take something that takes, you know, forever to build, and you put all your heart and soul, and some jackass reviewer that doesn't even, that plays it once and is on to the next thing and is just following hype and just cares about followers, to go and destroy what you've done. It's kind of weird. I mean, it's cool if they play it like 3 or 4 times, you know, 5 times, and decide, you know, this isn't really for me. Here's the reasons why I think this game is no good. That's a true critique of the work. But instead, the kind of critique that you have going on is, here is what people are going to think of your game after one play. And that's not really fair. In board games, I mean, in movies, it's fine. You don't necessarily have to watch a movie 2 or 3 times to get what's going on. But I think board games get a very unfair shake when it comes to reviewing. Content creators are incentivized to make content and make as much of it as they possibly can. Now, if their content happens to be reviewing games, their incentive isn't to be necessarily a good critique of games. It's to be entertaining and deliver content. There's far more money, I think, in following the hype and everything that's new than to be original have integrity about what your reviews are about, and making that the focus. That's just my personal opinion, obviously. It's just a strange world we live in when it comes to board games that are played once, put on the shelf. Like, we're waiting for all this great material to be made, great games to be made, and those that are in the know are playing games a minuscule amount of times and passing judgment on the work, and then expecting to be entertained even more with more games when they're not squeezing the juice from the games that they've already got. I mean, for me, it's ridiculous to play a game once or twice and then review it. But then the argument can be made, well, you know, I don't have the time to play games, you know, once or twice. And then the question becomes, who's putting you on the schedule? And then you start going through this questionnaire to them. Like, you basically pose a bunch of questions. You make a little questionnaire that gets it down to, you are a slave to clicks, or to how many people want to watch your reviews. And, you know, it's strange. You know, like, let's say monetization is your goal on YouTube or whatever. It's just strange that integrity, like I guess back in my day, that would have been like number one. Create content, but create content that is true and that is not I don't want to say a slave, but not tied to, are you reviewing the games with the biggest? Because I remember it was so telling. Like, I was listening to somebody talk about, you know, their viewership, and they talked about how nobody liked, or their viewership went down whenever they did a review. I mean, an interview, and it was up much higher when they just talked about the most current game. And then they saw that as, I guess, a way, I guess, to justify doing more new games. And I kept asking the question, what are you really in this for? Is it about the clicks? Is that all it is? There's other ways to get clicks instead of looking at guys, at people's designs, and tearing them down because you won't take the time to really explore what's going on. And it sounds like I have a bone to pick, and actually I kind of do, because that was a problem that I had with The Cost, is that it's not a game that you can understand usually the first game you play, the first time you play it. And I don't mind if you hate the game. If you played it five times and hate the game, you legitimately don't like the game. And if you played it only with two players, still, you could say, I didn't like this game at a two-player count, or whatever. So we're talking about an ultra-competitive market, where the reviewers aren't incentivized to promote the games that are more obscure. They're incentivized to promote what other people really like, and pretty pictures, and all the things that are very superficial, you know, surface level type stuff that gets people interested in Kickstarters or whatever. I think it's all horse shit, personally. I think that I think it'd be nice if we praised those people who did good work for the sake of doing good work. I'm not talking about designers. I'm talking about reviewers. Reviewers that do long form review or short form, it doesn't really matter as long as they actually care about the material, and whether it's a good review or a bad review, that's not the important part. The review, what's important, well, actually it's good to do a little bit of both. Review something, review things that you don't like, review things that you do like. There's a lot of people who won't review games that they don't like because the negative everybody needs a freaking trophy kind of idea or something. But I guess what I'm saying is, yeah, what are you saying? I am saying that when we find a reviewer that reviews games, that plays them several times, is that we should praise them whether they're liking the same games that we like or not. We should definitely let them know that they're doing God's work. Somebody's got to do it. What size is this one? Oh, it's a 4, but it's the wrong kind of 4. I've been going on about this shit for a while now. I don't mean on this stream. I just mean in the board game world. I guess it's just something that really kind of upsets me. I think that we could all do with a little bit more integrity. We could do a little bit more caring about the small people who do all the work instead of just trying to hey, there's no blue 4 here, god damn it. Alright, so we'll do the gray 4 and then I gotta go back and make blue 4s. Like I was saying, we should praise those who take the time to actually review work, and we should also when we get to in our own lives ask ourselves, what do we really want from a reviewer? What do we want from the purchases that we want to make? How do we want how do we want our hobby to grow? There's some serious curmudgeoning right now. Curmudgeon City. Okay, so we'll copy this, paste it. Let's do the blue 4. Blue 4. Cancel. Oh, crap, I didn't do the whole thing. Okay, blue 4. This is one side. This is the whole side. Cool, that's all the 4s. Let's do some 3s. We'll just get one of these. And we'll do it 5 times. 2. 1, 2, 3. That's 4, 5. We're doing the 3s. So we'll start with the red one. Backside of the red. next one after the red one is the blue one. I saw on Twitter the other day that somebody asked a question, and I thought the question was idiotic, but it wasn't, because somebody answered it in totally a weird way that I didn't expect. They said, okay, so like if somebody says, okay, so look, okay, so I'll start here. If you're gonna go dating people, a stupid question would be, to me, I guess, a stupid question would be, do you like pets? That's a pretty easy one. That's a low bar. Do you like pets? Like, no, I'm a crazy person. I don't like animals. You know, there are people out there who don't like animals, but if you're trying to make your best impression, you probably are not going to say, hey, I don't like animals. If you don't like animals, you'll say something like, I think animals are awesome. And then come up with the reason why you don't have animals, and come up with the reason why it's probably not a good idea to have pets or something, you know, something. At least that's what I assume. But I'm relating it to this question, which was, what do you think about trash talk in board games? And, you know, like, I expected that to be a stupid question. Everyone's like, yeah, I love it. I mean, there's some people that are sensitive to it, but the default should be, you know, even if you don't like it, like, I don't mind. Whatever floats people's boats, I guess. I assume this is what the default would be. I mean, I know that there's people who are sensitive to that kind of a thing. Well, several people said they didn't like it at all. And that, to me, was different. I can accept that people are different than I am. But I couldn't believe how much I misjudged that question was stupid, because there's no one who's going to be all like, well, okay, so the first part is, you know, trash talking shouldn't be a big deal. If you're going to be sensitive to trash talking amongst friends, well, the world's much more mean than that. That's my default, is saying that the world is very difficult. The world is very harsh and mean. And if you can't handle trash talk, well, you're lucky that that's the only thing you've had to handle, because that's very minor. And of course, that's, again, my curmudgeon-y self. I can't even imagine a world where hanging out with friends, the question is, you know, y'all start to trash talk, and then somebody gets upset about it, and then you get to hear about how it's insensitive to trash talk. Like, okay, so board games are not a sport, but it's at least adjacent to sports. You could never have played a sport, I think, and I mean, maybe you could have and not had trash talk. Obviously, this is a Mo problem. All right, so we got all of the stuff. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about what I've been thinking. That goes there. That's a five. Those are the five colors. Okay, so in these action spaces, I had this thing where you could Excuse me. You could select there's a type of action, and then there's a cubes. So the action, the places you select, you use the A and you flip it. I mean, yeah, you use an A and you flip it, and that says the department that you're on, and then the specific skills you're using within the department. Are you going to use the four different types of colors of cubes? And the reason why you have one of each, one is to further complicate how difficult it is to do something. But now I realize that I can use the actions to control the tempo. So I could make it in some of these things where you don't get the back side. They're only cubes. Or the back side has nothing. Or now they have letters for the actions. But if I, if my goal is to make it where you get a limited amount of actions but plenty of cubes, one of the ways to do that is that giving you the limited amount of actions. And another way to make sure you don't get fudged tons of them is by making it not available on the lower letters. So I use that as a control. I was been contemplating even taking it out and making it really easy to do an action. But now I'm going to use that as a timing mechanism. In not timing as in mechanism, like while you're playing the game, here's but like as a as you're following the calendar, those you'd only get a limited amount of actions per calendar, per month, and that dictates how far you can take a tequila down the thing. So yeah, that'll work. I'm going to stop right there. I'm starting to yawn and stuff, and I did what I needed to do. During that, it was kind of stressful because I had to fix the other computer and get it all right. But now that it's working, it's great. I'm going to stop there. I might come back if I stop this yawning. We'll see. Anyway, see if I can figure out how to turn this damn thing off.